Okay, now our last segment, we'll be discussing working with African American family caregivers. Now, in terms of caregiver characteristics, compared to Caucasian caregivers, African American caregivers are much more likely to be an extended family member and not a spouse. So it's pretty common for a adult child, often a daughter, sometimes their parents, their step folks. Those caregivers primarily are women, and they're often less likely to be married. And because of the demographic of older African Americans, they also are more likely to be members of a lower socioeconomic group. Part of the belief system among African Americans has to do with the primacy of home-based care. That it's still very it's very difficult to convince many African American caregivers that institutional placement, nursing home placement, is an option. It's something that they should consider. Most family members of all ages in the African American community would prefer home-based care. Another thing about African American caregivers: sometimes they aren't even blood kin. Sometimes they're non-blood kin, like family members and neighbors. Church communities often have church elders who look after others who are within that community. In general, among African American caregivers, they're more likely to provide that care in a collectivist manner instead of an individualistic caregiving system. So as opposed to all the responsibility falling on the wife or the daughter or the son, there's often a network of both family members, friends, and neighbors who are part of that. But in the future, there's still some question as to whether or not that family network is going to be available. Many times, children live far away from parents. They're not in the same community, elders living alone. So those large family networks may not actually be present for practical support in the future. And we're already seeing more African Americans accessing formal care like adult-based health services and nursing home care, largely because those family networks have become more dispersed as people have moved away. Now, attitudes towards caregiving. Many studies have shown that African Americans have particular reasons for why they feel it's important to care for older adults in their family. Some of the things that have come up in terms of attitudes towards caregiving include affection for the elder, gratification from the experience of caregiving, and a reciprocity for the past kindness and care of that elder. My mother or father took care of me when I was young, so it's what I'm supposed to do. It's a family responsibility and a moral obligation to take care of my older adult when they need that care. Now, I know a lot of studies have started to look at where does that responsibility, that obligation, and that energy start to fall apart? When does it start to fray? What are some of the predictors of caregiver burden? Because that's often when people start, especially African Americans, come for formal care. They talk with their primary care doctor, or they may talk to their minister. It's when they're not able to manage all the responsibilities of caregiving. So many studies have started to look at how caregiver burden evolves in different ethnic groups. Now, the studies indicate that African American, compared to Caucasian caregivers, they actually report less stress, less depression, and less burden. But few of those cross-cultural studies are based on representative samples, so it's difficult to generalize about all African American caregivers. There may be some difference in reporting because there's so much family obligation and moral responsibility towards being a caregiver. People will not complain. To even talk about burden implies that you are not holding up the bargain, the social bargain within your community to provide that care without complaint. So also how people express depression. That may also, it's really clear that many African Americans express depression in a different way. They may not say that I feel depressed, but if you ask them about sleep problems, energy problems, worsening health problems, that they will admit to. So there's a number of aspects of these cross-cultural studies on caregiver burden that haven't been explored. Now, another area, because health education and education about dementia has become a critical aspect of providing public education and helping people access care, how illness beliefs about dementia vary from ethnic group to ethnic group is another area that's become of increasing of interest. Now, a more recent study back in 2003 indicated that African Americans, compared to Caucasian caregivers, said they really knew less about dementia. They had less factual information about the symptoms and the evolution of dementia. They also said they had fewer information sources about the disease. And in spite of the fact that the statistics are very, very clear that African Americans are at greater risk for dementia, they perceive themselves of having less of a risk for dementia. So those some of those aspects of their belief systems, their access to information about dementia, may underlie the reasons that they appear in health settings at a later stage of the illness, because they know less about the illness and they may not feel that it's something that that they are more at risk for. Also, but African Americans compared to Caucasian caregivers did have similar beliefs about some of the common symptoms of dementia, some of the risk factors, and the effectiveness of the current treatments for dementia at this time. Now, as I had mentioned earlier, one of the really critical belief systems about dementia among African Americans is the fact that many believe that dementia is part of normal aging. So if you believe that memory loss and confusion are part of what happens when you get older, you just get senile, there's less reason to be alarmed, there's less reason to attempt to pursue health practitioners for cures or solutions, because it's part of what all older people experience. So again, we believe that's one of the areas that causes a delay in diagnosis and a delay in accessing care. Also, there are African Americans who believe that Alzheimer's is due to stress, that there are external things that, quote, cause the illness. So there's a feeling if you reduce the stress, you're less likely to get Alzheimer's disease. African Americans also really question how effective prevention measures are concerning the prevention and treatment of dementia and Alzheimer's disease. And this is where a lot of energy is being focused to really let people know that attending to diet, comorbid medical illnesses, physical activity, all of those seem to have a real effect on people's, on the expression of dementia, on people's experience of the illness if they do get it. That information is increasingly become a core piece of dementia education and public outreach. Other belief systems that African Americans have about dementia is they really think they're more negative consequences, that it is almost a death sentence, and there's a lot of stigma associated with dementia. Finally, in spite of all the things we've said before, there's a belief system among many older adults that scientists are on the brink of making a significant advance in Alzheimer's treatment, that there's a cure right around the corner. There are people who believe that there'll be a medication, some sort of a pill that will turn back the ravages of Alzheimer's in the near future. Now, caregivers and burden, and how do they cope with this devastating illness, which affects so many people in this country and will in the future? Many of the studies of caregiving and coping have indicated that African Americans compared to Caucasian caregivers actually report lower levels of anxiety and a better sense of well-being. They seem to have less distress about the memory problems and the behavior problems that are associated with the person they're taking care of. They also are less likely to use antidepressants or other psychotropic medications to manage behavioral problems at home. And many African-American caregivers report that what gets them through the day is religious coping and religious participation, everything from praying at home to interfacing with other caregivers from their faith community to going to church. Those are the things that seem to be at the forefront of helping people manage a very difficult situation. Now, African Americans compared to Caucasian caregivers also have focused on a lot of the positive aspects of caregiving for them. They've reported higher levels of caregiver satisfaction, that this is part of a traditional caregiving ideology, that this is what you do. It's something that's reinforced and supported and praised within your community and within your family. they generally feel that they have higher levels of self-efficacy. They feel that they can manage things at home very effectively. Whether or not that's the case or not, but there's generally a sense that there's something good that is gained from the experience of being a caregiver, that they perceive a lot of positive aspects of caregiving. And as I mentioned before, many times this is wrapped up within religious beliefs and a lot of support from their faith-based communities. Now, some of the dynamic between African American caregivers and their health practitioners, where there are bumps in the road, has become a major area for intervention and for research. Initially, the sense was that cultural beliefs were a primary factor in people receiving cognitive assessment. That if you, as we said before, believe that dementia is part of normal aging, that will make you less likely to access care. Now, that is true, but some of the more recent studies are indicating that African-American caregivers' limited knowledge about Alzheimer's actually trumps those cultural beliefs, that people don't realize that it is an illness, that there are particular tests that you do need to interface with your primary provider, and that there are prevention measures that can be put into play. Because people don't know that, that's actually a bigger deterrent to them initiating cognitive assessment. Also, another area that's starting to be more recognized is the fact that physicians may fail to recognize dementia symptoms in African Americans, and they're less likely to refer them to more specialized facilities. That physicians' behaviors, their practice patterns, are actually more problematic than language or ethnic differences when we're talking about African American elders. So physicians' failure to actually recognize dementia symptoms and to go the next step of referring them for more specific testing, that's a major obstacle in people accessing dementia care early in the course of things. In fact, in the study done by Mahoney, physicians' disrespect for African Americans' caregivers' concerns about the declining abilities of their care recipients and the physician's reluctance to initiate dementia assessment was actually reported by a number of African American caregivers. And I've actually had this happen in my practice where caregivers will say, well, I knew that Dad was having problems. He almost set the house on fire. I talked to my primary care doctor, but he didn't do anything. He says, oh, he's just getting older. That's something that people are recognizing, that the dynamic between healthcare practitioners and African American caregivers is something that needs, we need a lot of work in that area. Recommendations. What can we do? I think in the future, we really need, as health practitioners, to be more aware of cultural sensitivity and communications training. I think it's something that actually has to be done throughout the course of a person's practice, not just in medical school or not just in nursing school. It's something that we really need continued education and support around. That we need to customize the memory loss information in primary care and community settings so that the general public is more aware of the symptoms of dementia, the access to resources, the types of resources that are available for caregivers, that those need to be more available. We need to continue to offer community education, reinforcing Alzheimer's disease as a recognized disease with social acceptability, that this isn't something that you need to hide from to try and get rid of the stigma associated with Alzheimer's disease and let people know that this is an illness that it's a difficult illness, but we do have interventions and strategies to assist with that. The same way cancer used to be a death sentence. Now people are really aware of, you know, different types of cancer and the resources that are available. We also need to develop consumer education resources that are tailored to the viewer's interests and linguistics. And these days we have, you know, the options of everything from DVD to smartphones to websites to really make people aware that there's information at hand at their fingertips that can be very useful to them. Finally, there are a number of opportunities for practitioners and the general public to get background in cross-cultural sensitivity and communications training online. The Administration on Aging's website for cultural competency is a wonderful resource, and also Community Partnerships for Older Adults. Their website has a number of resources that can be helpful in this area.